Okay, so thanks again to Dean Cooper for the nice introduction, and of course, ONG Homes for sponsoring this evening. As was mentioned, I'm a professor in the Department of Chemistry and Biochemistry at the University of Lethbridge, and I'm a chemist by training. So tonight I wanted to start by getting you to think about what the word chemical means to you. And maybe when you hear the word chemical, you think of adjectives such as dangerous, harmful, toxic, hazardous, poisonous, harsh, or carcinogenic. Or maybe you think of items such as pesticides, household cleaners, drugs, maybe you think of Breaking Bad, pollutants, preservatives or processed foods, beauty treatments like Botox, or chemical weapons. And overall, I think this is a very negative list, and I claim that there's a reason for this negativity. And to illustrate this point, I wanted to discuss a compound that I'll call dihydrogen monoxide, or DHMO. DHMO is used as a flame retardant. It's used in pesticide distribution. In fact, even when you wash your fruits and vegetables, some of this chemical can remain on them. It's used by grocery stores in order to keep your produce looking nice and fresh. It's an industrial solvent. It's used in nuclear power plants and to manufacture weapons and styrofoam. It's also added to baby food. It's used by all major beer producers. It's used by major coffee houses. It's included in pharmaceuticals and personal care products like shampoos, shaving cream, even bubble bath for kids. It's used in community swimming pools and to enhance athletic performance. When we think about the effects of DHMO, it could be considered to be quite bad for the environment. It's a major component of acid rain. It causes erosion and corrosion. It causes severe burns. And it's even found in tumors of terminal cancer patients. Overexposure leads to excessive sweating and urination, nausea, vomiting, electrolyte imbalance. Overall, this sounds like an absolutely horrible chemical. This is a picture of one molecule of DHMO. Di means two, so there's two hydrogens, which are the white blobs here. Mono is one, so there's one oxygen, which is the red part of the molecule. Wait a minute here, maybe this doesn't seem so bad. And in fact, it's not. What I was describing to you is water. And I think this is an excellent example of how portraying a chemical in a certain light does to our perception of what that chemical does or how it may affect us. And I think it's also a great example that illustrates the importance of chemical literacy. This is a hoax you may have heard of before. It dates way back to the 80s, where a newspaper in Michigan actually reported on April Fool's Day, of course, that the city's water supply contained this chemical and that it's fatal if inhaled. So I would claim that chemical literacy is even more important today than maybe it was even back in the 80s. And as an example, a good friend of mine started her own home business selling cleaning products. And I was trying to be the good supportive friend that I am, and I was flipping through the catalog, and I couldn't believe the statements about chemicals, and I have some of them here. The first one, say goodbye to harmful chemical cleaners. A chemical-free kitchen is truly a clean kitchen. You will be part of the movement to create safe, chemical-free spaces if you buy our products. No chemicals, heats, or solvents touch these precious ingredients. You have to ask yourself, does that make you feel better about buying these products? And maybe it does, but that's a lot to do with the marketing, right? The same company sells various cleansers, and they call these cleansers agents. Are agents okay, but chemicals are bad? What about synthetic versus natural? A lot of people think synthetic compounds are bad for us, and if it's natural, it must be okay. What about conventional versus organic farming? And I'm not even going to go there. If you know me, you'll know why. So this is our current reality. This is the way companies are marketing chemicals and the media is portraying chemicals. Even this week, the Home and Garden Show is on in Lethbridge, and there was a talk yesterday, Gardening Without Chemicals, Protect Your Soil, Protect Your Food. right? We always portray these chemicals in a negative light. And this has led to a term that's been coined, chemophobia. And this is the irrational fear of synthetic substances, basically arising from scare stories and exaggerated claims about their danger that are prevalent in the media. So what's the truth then? So I'm here tonight to tell you the chemical truth. What's the chemical truth? The truth is everything is a chemical. Everything is made of the basic building blocks that we call atoms. A chemical can be a solid, a liquid, or a gas. It can be a mixture of different compounds, or it could be a pure compound. It could be made in the lab, or it could occur naturally. Examples are artificial vanilla flavoring. That's a chemical. But so is pure vanilla extract. The contact lens solution that you use, that's a chemical. Look at all of you with those beautiful beverages tonight. Those are chemicals. The other part of the chemical truth is that chemistry is everywhere. We use chemistry when we cook, when we clean water, design renewable energy sources, ensure global food security, or discover new drugs. And surely these don't sound like bad things to do. So my job as a chemist is to study chemistry. So what motivates chemists? Well, chemists like to ask a lot of different questions. Some of them I've listed here. So it's things like, what is this material made of? How long did it take to make? Will it last or will it change and why? Can we control these changes in some way? Is this material useful? Are there new uses for it? And can we make it? And these are the questions that drive chemists forward. And basically, it's if we can better understand the composition of the world around us, we'll be in a better position to appreciate our environment and understand ourselves, and hopefully be in a better position in order to make our lives better in some way, too. And I argue that by understanding all of this chemistry, we'll also be able to promote chemical literacy and help the media and companies market and portray chemicals in the right light. Now, there's another question that chemists ask, and that is this material hazardous? And this comes back to my own work that we do here at the University of Lethbridge. So what is it that we study? Well, this is the title of my talk, and I've bolded in red the first part of the title, DNA Damage, Repair, and Disease. So basically, now that I've spent all this time trying to convince you that everything's a chemical and that they're not all bad, I'm going to spend the rest of my talk explaining to you how exposure to chemicals may not be so great, but just some things. So, first we need to start by talking about DNA. What is DNA? DNA stands for deoxyribonucleic acid. It contains our genetic information. It's what makes us who we are, right? From our hair color, to our eye color, to our height. DNA is a chemical. This is a picture of the structure of DNA, and you can think of it as a twisted ladder. So the backbone or the sides of the ladder are in black here, and on the ladder runs, we see various colors. And our genetic information is contained within those ladder rungs. You'll see I used four colors to draw my DNA, and that's because those four ladder rungs contain or four DNA bases, or what we call bases. And here are the chemical structures of the bases. They're known as cytosine, guanine, adenine, or thymine, or maybe you know them by the single letter codes C, G, A, and T. And we see that the chemical structure of these bases is very specific. Their shape is very specific. So they fit together in a certain way, such that C and G, or the blue and the yellow, always appear opposite each other in that DNA ladder. And the red and the green, or T and A, always fit together in a rung of that DNA ladder. And it's the specific pairing that's so important for maintaining our genetic information as cells grow and divide. So what happens as cells grow and divide is that DNA is copied. So here I've turned DNA on its side, and on the left, you can see part of the ladder. And then that DNA has been unzipped into two single strands. And within cells, there's some free bases, and we have enzymes that insert those free bases according to that blue, yellow, green, red color code. And that generates a new DNA ladder. That happens on both of those single strands of DNA so that we end up with two perfect copies of that original DNA ladder. Now, when we think about this process, we can see why it's so important that those bases fit together very specifically, because we want that order of bases contains our genetic information, and we want that information to be maintained. But that chemical makeup that affects the shape of the bases can change. And in fact, it's been estimated that our DNA is damaged 60,000 times per cell per day. So what's the consequence of this damage? Well, if we consider healthy cell division, one cell becomes two, and that DNA in the original cell is contained in perfect copies in the other two cells. And then each of those cells can go on and divide into two again. And then at some point, that cell growth stops. If the DNA is damaged in one of those cells, what happens in healthy cell division is what we call controlled cell death. And this is exactly what we want, right? If the DNA has changed its structure or become damaged, we don't want that damage or that error to be passed on to other cells. So this is a good thing. In contrast, in cancer cell division, once the DNA is damaged, mutations can happen. And we can have subsequent mutations that then lead to uncontrolled cell growth. And it's that collection of mutated cells that can lead to tumor development. So what does this damaged DNA look like anyway? Now don't panic. I am a chemist, so I had to show some molecules. I wouldn't be a good chemist if I didn't, but there aren't too many. And you don't need to take in the whole structure here. I'm showing you an example of the chemical structure of one of those DNA ladder runs, the base A, on the left. And it's undergone some chemical reaction, which is indicated by the arrow, in order to form the molecule on the right. And we see that that red group has been added to that molecule on the right. And you can probably appreciate that that red group seems quite small compared to the original A that's there. And you might think, well, this isn't such a big deal. But in fact, that little red group can stop the enzymes from copying DNA. So this could lead to cell death. As another example, here on the left, we have the base C, which naturally occurs on one of those DNA ladder rungs. And it's again undergone a chemical reaction to form a new molecule, and they just differ in that blue region. But this is a big problem because although C pairs with G to give us that yellow-blue pairing, the new molecule on the right-hand side pairs with A. So when DNA is copied in this case, instead of having a yellow-blue DNA ladder rung, we would have a yellow-red DNA ladder rung, and our genetic information has changed. In my lab, we're interested in understanding how compounds that are either known carcinogens or suspected carcinogens modify the chemical structure of the DNA bases. And I've shown some example sources here. These can range from agricultural contaminants, industrial environmental pollutants, the foods we eat, estrogen, either that occurs naturally in our bodies or that's introduced through hormone replacement therapies, PBA in plastics, red food dye, even plants. Some plants, don't panic, some plants. All of these things contain compounds that are processed in our bodies to generate byproducts that then add to one of those natural DNA bases. Here are some example chemical structures. Oops. Sorry about that. Am I good? Here are some example DNA structures. The natural base is shown in black, and then the damage shows up in red again. And it's important for you to understand, I guess, that these are bigger than that little red group that I showed you before. And they also vary in terms of their size, in terms of the atoms that are involved in that red group. And in addition to being different in terms of their chemical structure, we know that the exposure to these various compounds lead to different health outcomes. So we know smoking leads to lung cancer, this plant actually leads to bladder cancer, and various estrogen mimics have been linked to breast cancer. So The other thing that's important to tell you here is that some of these damaged bases have actually been found in human tumor tissue, and they're well accepted to be early hallmarks of tumor formation. In my lab, here are some examples of the compounds that we're currently interested in studying. And again, the black parts, the original DNA, and the red groups are the things that have been added. And you can see the great variation in terms of the chemistry that could happen in terms of the atoms that are involved here. And what we're interested in understanding is how do these damaged bases form, and then once they are formed, what happens to them inside the cells? So what happens to damaged DNA? In order to explain this, let's take a little piece of natural DNA and assume that some damaging event happened to this blue base and that became mutated in some way. Now, the good news is we're all here, right? So 60,000 times per cell per day, it didn't take us out yet. So there is good news. And the good news is we have enzymes in our bodies that can fix this or repair the damaged DNA. They can remove that damage and replace it with that original blue base to maintain that blue-yellow DNA ladder rung. But that repair process isn't perfect. And sometimes the DNA is copied before the repair happens. And if that's the case, what could happen is that the enzymes that are copying DNA could put the wrong base opposite that damage. So here we see a red base has been inserted opposite the damage base. So instead of a blue-yellow pair, we have that damage opposite something red. So again, we've changed that genetic code. We can also get crazier things happen that are known as deletion mutations. So here we've deleted bases. Basically, the enzyme wasn't quite sure what to put opposite that damaged base, so it just didn't put anything. So within that red box, you see we've got a yellow-blue DNA ladder rung maintained, and then we have our damaged base, and then a green base kind of hanging out by itself, and then we have another red-green DNA ladder rung maintained again. So within that red box, the strand on the right has two bases in it, and the strand on the left had four. So we've lost some of the bases or lost some genetic information. So what we want to understand is how different DNA addicts lead to different outcomes. And only by understanding I guess how the repair happens, will we understand why these damaged products show up in human tumor tissues? And only by understanding what types of mutations may form will we understand the consequences of this damage. A great example of the success, or I guess a success story of this research, came about in the media back in the fall of 2015, and that's related to the carcinogenicity of red and processed meats. And basically, the story goes that when you cook your steak over an open flame on your barbecue and you char it, you will generate compounds known as heterocyclic aromatic amines. And if you cook that thing beyond recognition, you will generate polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. And both of those compounds can be processed in our bodies and generate the byproducts that attach to and damage a DNA base. And it was research that related the charring of the meat to the formation of DNA addicts and the connection to diseases such as cancer that led the International Agency for Research on Cancer classifying red meat as probably being carcinogenic to humans. Similarly, processed meat was classified as being carcinogenic to humans. Now, this is a great example of the importance of the work, But it's also, in my opinion, a little bit of failure of the media, because when the headlines came out, and perhaps even as you're reading the title of my slide, a lot of people interpreted this to mean red meat causes cancer. The reality is, if you cook your steak rare or medium rare, you're not going to generate these compounds. So you can have your Alberta beef, you just have to cook it right. Okay? Another good example of the importance of this work is a compound known as ochratoxin A. This is a toxin. It arises from different fungal species, and it often makes its way into our food source. So, for example, contaminated pork products, a lot of wheat crops are contaminated. Other crops like coffee, wine grapes, which I tend to ignore, and other fruit crops as well. Ochratoxin A has been determined to be a potent renal carcinogen in many animal models, and the International Agency for Research on Cancer has classified ochratoxin A as a possible human carcinogen. The problem is our recommended tolerable daily intake varies for different regions of the world, and that's because we don't understand how ochratoxin A works. So specifically, there's currently two schools of thought. There's what's known as an indirect mechanism. So ochratoxin A does something in the cell, and then that goes on and does something else. So it's indirectly causing a problem. Or there's also a direct mechanism where ochratoxin A adds to a DNA base, like I've shown here. In Canada, the formation of DNA damage is considered to be a viable outcome and a viable option for how ochratoxin A exerts its effects. So Health Canada has set nice, stringent, tolerable daily intakes for ochratoxin A. But the European Food Safety Association, or authority, sets the tolerable daily intake that's more associated with that indirect mechanism. So only by understanding whether a compound actually affects DNA and what the connection are to various health outcomes will we be in a better position in order to legislate our exposure to these species. So what information do we need? Well, the first thing we need to know is what does that damaged DNA look like? And as a chemist, I'll probably say, what's the structure? What's the structure of that damaged DNA? Remember this slide where I said, once DNA is damaged, enzymes can either fix it or they'll copy it. So that tells us, okay, in addition to knowing what the damaged DNA looks like, we also have to understand how these enzymes work. How do the enzymes process damaged DNA? So here I'm showing you two different enzymes, which is the blue spaghetti, and the DNA is the yellow part of the molecule. And we want to understand at the atomic level how these things work. Now, this is quite fundamental research, understanding how the enzymes work, but there's some very important applications to this. And that is many cancer drugs on the market actually work by causing DNA damage. In this case, it's a good thing, right? We want to cause the damage, we want the cell to die. But what we don't want is for that repair enzyme to come in and fix the damage that we purposely caused. And what we definitely don't want is for the enzyme that copies DNA to start copying past the damage and potentially introducing other mutations. So by understanding how these enzymes work, we might be in a better position in order to design these drugs in a way that the enzymes can't get past them. Or we might be in a better position to design drugs to control the function of those enzymes and complement existing drug strategies that we have. So, how do I try to contribute to this problem at the University of Lethbridge? Well, the second part of my talk was how, or title of my talk, is how computers can help us understand. And now you're thinking she's totally lost me. She said she was a chemist, she's talked about biology, and now she's talking about computers, right? And I say, yes, I know. There is definitely a widespread historic stereotype of a chemist probably being a male, dressed in a white lab coat, playing with some chemicals, I probably shouldn't have said playing, working hard with instrumentation, maybe holding a special molecule, or maybe you think of the mad scientist approach, right? With crazy hair, bubbling chemicals. But I'm here tonight to tell you that not all chemists wear white lab coats. And in particular, this is a picture of my chemistry lab. As Dean Cooper mentioned, I'm what you call a computational chemist, or I do molecular modeling. Simply put, we use computers' calculations to get information about chemical and biochemical systems. So we do chemistry by computers. Why, you ask? Why would you want to do that, Stacey? Well, I argue computers can provide us atomic level information that we need in order to understand DNA damage and repair. So when you think of the height of a five-year-old child or the width of your hand or the width of a finger, all of these things are things you can easily see with your eyes, right? The thickness of a human hair, red blood cells, bacterium, these are things we can see with a microscope. When we get down to the level of a DNA molecule or an individual base on the rung of a DNA ladder or the atoms, we need specialized techniques. And for me, our specialized technique that we use in my lab are computers. Now, why would we choose computers over other techniques? Well, I'd say there's lots of reasons. I may argue cost, in terms of the one-time cost of computers versus the ongoing, reoccurring cost of chemicals. That's certainly what my synthetic colleagues always complain about, their expensive chemicals that they have to buy. I would argue it is safe. I can study explosive compounds. I can study toxic things just as safely as I can study nice, stable molecules. It's informative. I can get information that is maybe a little easier to get sometimes than experimental studies. But I would really argue that the power of using computer modeling comes when it's used in combination with experimental studies. So either to complement experiments, basically just giving us another tool to study chemical systems, giving us another piece of the puzzle that we're trying to solve. We can also use calculations to guide experiment, and probably a great example here is drug design, where we can use computer calculations to test the activity of many different compounds and then select some targets for the synthetic chemist to go away and make and then undergo testing. Of course, those parts are still super important too, but computers can be used in part of that process. What information can we get from calculations? Well, I would argue anything we can go into the lab and measure, we can calculate too. So that list was a list of some structural features that wet chemists like to go into the lab and measure, and I would say that everything that they can measure, we can calculate. How do we do it? Well, here's a screenshot of one of the pieces of software that we use in my lab. This happens to be a Windows-based software. We use this even with undergraduate students. It might look somewhat familiar if you use Word or Excel. You'll see that there's some drop-down menus, or maybe you can't see, it's pretty tiny. File, it says File, Edit. These are drop-down menus you're used to seeing. There's also wonderful icons, and one icon that we click on pops up an entire periodic table. So we can build any molecule that we can think of in order to study that on computers. There's also a nice DNA button that generates any part of DNA so we can build our DNA models. Now, of course, in addition to software, we need hardware in order to run our calculations. And my students do have nice desktop computers with various monitors. But those personal computers just aren't powerful enough to perform the calculations that we want to run related to DNA damage and repair. So instead, we use what's known as a computer cluster. Basically, this is many computers all linked together so that they can work together on the problem. So for example, if we use one computer to run a calculation and it takes 2 weeks or 14 days, if we instead use 14 computers to run that calculation, we would hope then it would only take 1 day. That's kind of the idea behind a cluster. It's not that perfect in the real world, but that's the idea. In our projects related to DNA damage, at an absolute minimum, the projects take what we call 20 core years. So if we ran that project on one computer, it would take 20 years to complete. And that, my graduate students would tell you, is if everything goes right the first time, which isn't the case in research very often. So we need an extensive amount of computer power. That's even without adding the enzymes, I should say. So once we add the enzymes, things get even more complicated. So we do need a lot of computers. This lets us run more calculations. It lets us get more accurate data, which means it's more reliable compared to experimental data. And it allows us to do calculations on larger systems, where basically the more atoms we have, the longer the calculations take. This is actually a picture of one of the computer clusters we have at the University of Lethbridge dedicated to use in my group. This cluster we affectionately called uracil. Uracil is actually a type of DNA damaged base, or one of those DNA ladder rungs. But for us, uracil means the upscale and robust abacus for chemistry in Lethbridge, right? I learned when I moved to Alberta, you can make anything into a good acronym. The second cluster that we have is called nucleic, and nucleic is the N in DNA. And for us, nucleic means the new upscale cluster for Lethbridge to enable innovative chemistry. Together, these two clusters have over 1,000 computers all linked together. We also use a national compute platform known as Computer CalcU Canada, and this is a national agency where researchers in all disciplines across the country can apply for time on those high-performance computers. But I think one of the advantages of being a researcher at the University of Lethbridge is that the university is very supportive to its researchers, and they want us to have the tools we need in order to get our work done. So we're very lucky to have our own dedicated resources. And this is really important for my group in particular because of the amount of computer time we need. It also means we're not competing against other people when we want to run a calculation or have the next great idea. We have the resources right there to do our job. So, what do we do with all of these computers? Well, remember, the title was DNA Damage, Repair, and Disease by Computers. So basically, we use many different types of models. We start by looking at the DNA base on the DNA ladder rung. We add the backbone in black. We might have a couple of bases next to each other. We build up the DNA double helix. And then we add the enzymes in there, too. But we don't do this in a bubble, and it's really important to understand that. We make sure that we understand the experimental literature related to what we're doing, and we also have great experimental collaborators as well. So as an example, on some of our work related to DNA damage, we collaborate with Richard Manderville's group at the University of Guelph. And they actually go into the lab and make the damaged bases. They incorporate them into DNA helices, and then they study the chemical properties of that damaged DNA helix. They then send those damaged helices to Shauna Sterla's lab in Switzerland, where they look at the biochemistry and look at how the damaged DNA interacts with these important enzymes. And then here in Lethbridge, we do the calculations, so we calculate the properties in order to help the experimentalists understand what is it that they're seeing or make predictions about the potential biochemical outcomes. So I'm going to show you just a couple of examples. I'll try to keep it at a pretty high level of recent results. I'll get excited about this because it is pretty recent, so I'll try not to talk forever now. So this is one type of damaged DNA that we've just recently studied in my lab. Again, the black part is one of those natural DNA bases on the DNA ladder rung. It's a G, and we've added that red group to it. Now, remember I said we want to first understand what does that damaged DNA look like? Now, there are experimental techniques that can give us that information. So there's a sophisticated technique called X-ray crystallography. What we can do is we can make the damaged DNA, as I described that Richard does in Guelph, and then we can shine X-rays at it in order to get a picture of what it looks like. That sounds great, but it's very difficult to grow those crystals, and it's actually a bit of an art. And it's also very time-consuming to solve what the structure looks like. So we can't do that for many different types of damaged DNA that we want to study. We can also put the damaged DNA in solution and use a technique known as NMR spectroscopy, and that's what this picture was obtained with. So my graduate student went into the lab. We do that sometimes, not very often, but sometimes. So he went into the lab under close supervision of somebody else and recorded this spectra. So this is our experimental picture of what the damaged DNA looks like. What we get from this picture is that there's one big peak. Does everybody see that one big peak? Does that tell us what the damaged DNA looks like? Not so much. But it does tell us that there's one dominant structure that this damaged DNA adopts. We then go to the computer and we can calculate many different structures. We can use special techniques to search how many different ways can this damaged DNA look. And we can determine which structure is most likely or most probable to occur. And when we do this, this is the picture that we generate of the damaged DNA. So again, the red group that's been added is the thing that's been added, and this time it's been added to that green DNA ladder rung. And what we see is that red group kind of hangs off to the side. The DNA ladder rung in green looks much like the ones in blue, meaning that it hasn't changed much. So from our calculations, we were able to get this atomic level picture of what the damaged DNA looks like. And it allowed us to say, you know what? Probably if enzymes copy this, it's going to treat this particular type of damage much like the original undamaged DNA. And that's exactly what our experimental collaborators saw. As another example, what happens when we make that piece of damage a little bigger? So again, in black is the natural DNA base guanine, and the red group's been added on. And you see this time from our experimental picture, there's two big peaks. So what do they correspond to? Again, we go away to our computers, and we set up some calculations, and the first structure, which corresponds to the smaller peak, has that red group, again, hanging off to the side, and the green DNA ladder rung that was damaged looks much like the blue ones, meaning not a lot happened to the overall structure. The second structure, however, has that red group kind of pushed inside the DNA helix. And as I spin this one around, you'll see this time that DNA ladder rung is disrupted. And this disruption allowed us to predict that the enzymes that copy DNA are going to have a bit of a problem here, and something not so great is going to happen. And that's exactly what our experimental collaborators saw for this particular type of damage. One more example. This is, I don't know, you might not remember it, but we talked about ochratoxin A, that fungal toxin. This is the chemical structure of the damaged base arising from ochratoxin A. And this time, we have no experimental information about what the structure of damaged DNA looks like. Nobody's been successful yet synthesizing or making the molecule, or let alone putting it inside a DNA helix. So, what we do know is that when we expose cells to ochratoxin A, we see different outcomes, depending on the type of cell that's examined. So this suggests that depending on the environment of the cell, different things are going to happen. And this time, when we went away and did our calculations, we found three different structures of damaged DNA that were almost equally likely. In the first one, the red group is coming out of the screen towards you. In the middle one, it's going away in back of the screen. And in the third one, the red group is inside the DNA helix. And all of these different structures are treated differently by the enzymes that process damaged DNA. And we can actually correlate these structures to what was observed in terms of the outcomes in those cell lines. So again, using the computers, we can get this atomic level picture of what that damaged DNA looks like and correlate that to the experimental data. I also said we basically want it all, right? We want to know how the enzymes process DNA too. So here on the left, I'm showing you one enzyme that acts on damaged DNA. That enzyme's the blue spaghetti and the DNA's in yellow. And what I've done is I've zoomed in on the part of the enzyme that does all the chemistry, the part of the enzyme that works so hard. So that's what's blown up here in the box. And in the box, on the bottom, you'll see a DNA ladder rung in yellow. That's unchanged. That's just a normal DNA ladder rung. And then we have the damaged base in red on the left. And there's a green thing coming in. So that's the job of this enzyme. This enzyme is copying DNA. So remember, it's putting a base opposite the damage. So we can actually do calculations where we put different bases opposite that damage and make predictions about which chemical reaction is most likely. And that helps us understand what mutation might happen to the DNA. The other thing that we can do is you'll see some blue molecules here as well. Those are actually parts of the enzyme. So we can tell what each of those little parts of the enzyme are actually doing. And again, by understanding how that enzyme works, we might be in a better position in order to stop it from copying past damage that we've introduced by a cancer drug. Or we might be in a better position to control the function of that enzyme in some way. But these are things that we can see by doing computer calculations. So hopefully I've convinced you that we can get useful information on DNA damage and repair, but this slide highlights that there's a lot of other projects of interest in my group, and you'll notice another acronym here, RNA. That's not a typo. I did that on purpose. RNA is another very essential molecule that's important to us and important in our cells, and we are also interested in damage to RNA. So first, what is RNA? Well, RNA is a chemical, just like DNA is a chemical. This basic picture is often used to explain the function of RNA, where the genetic information in DNA is copied into RNA, and then that information in RNA is used to make proteins. So you can imagine if we have damage to the RNA, that could be pretty bad too, because maybe we get proteins that don't work or that do something that they weren't meant to do. So this is part of another ongoing area of my research. But I wanted to introduce this tonight because I wanted to tell you that this is not all that RNA does. That RNA is actually quite an exciting molecule. There's many different types of RNA, and it has many key functions inside our cell. Changes in RNA have been related to different diseases. It's been said maybe it can carry some genetic information, for example, in viruses. It can be an enzyme. There's lots of different roles. And this is a new and emerging area of research. And because of that, many countries in Europe and sites across the United States have entire research centers focused on RNA. And we're really lucky at the University of Lethbridge to have our own RNA-centered research center. We call it ARTI, which stands for the Alberta RNA Research and Training Institute. And ARTI was the first, I think it's still the only, RNA center in Alberta. It brings together 8 core researchers at the University of Lethbridge, including myself, 5 of whom hold research chairs, and it involves over 50 trainees who all work together in order to study problems related to RNA, in order to understand this basic molecule that's so important to life. Now, I'm super lucky because in my department we have a second research institute, and the second research institute is called CCRAFT. And CCRAFT stands for the Canadian Centre for Research in Advanced Fluorine Technologies. So you may have noticed on my damaged DNA that I showed you, there is an F hanging off the side. And that's a fluorine atom. In my research, we use that fluorine atom as a probe. Because that fluorine was there, we were able to get those experimental pictures that told us how many different conformations the damaged DNA might adopt. Fluorine has many other uses. It's been estimated to be used in about 20% of all pharmaceuticals. It's also been estimated, I think it's 30 to 40% of agrochemicals as well. So this understanding the chemistry of the element fluorine and designing new chemicals and new materials that contain this element might generate new uses or new things for us to make our lives better. CCRAFT again brings together 8 core researchers in both the Department of Chemistry and Biochemistry, as well as the Department of Physics, and again about 55 trainees, all focused on projects related to the element fluorine. Now you might be wondering, how on earth did this Maritimer end up here? So where's Dean Cooper? I can't see him in the light, but this is a picture outside St. John, New Brunswick. It's a very common mistake. If you want to fly to St. John, be careful. Make sure you get on the right plane, or you will end up in Newfoundland. So this picture was taken on the Kingston Peninsula, and it's a picture of the St. John River. That's where my family grew up. As was mentioned, I attended Mount Allison University, and you may not know that Mount Allison University is a small, primarily undergraduate liberal arts institution, much like the University of Lethbridge. And during my time at university, in my second year, in fact, a math professor approached me about participating in summer research. And I thought, well, this sounds a little different. Sounds a lot better than the shoe store and the hotel that I had worked at other summers. So I thought I'd give it a try. And that was a real pivotal moment in my academic career because it taught me that I did not want to become a mathematician. So the next summer, a chemistry professor approached me, and I thought, okay. So I spent the summer in a traditional wet experimental chemistry lab. And again, this was another very pivotal moment because it turned out that I could not become an experimental chemist because I broke way too much and I spilt a lot as well. So that was not the place for me. So that fall, I was really wondering what on earth I was going to do. And somebody came to the university to give a talk, and he explained how we use computers in order to study chemistry. And I thought, aha, I can use my math background in order to study chemistry in a safe environment. This sounds like the spot for me. So I completed my PhD at Dalhousie University under the supervision of the speaker, who was Russell Boyd. In science, once we finish our PhD, we then go on to what's known as a postdoctoral fellow position, and that's a pure research position in order to get experience in different research labs and in different environments. And I completed my postdoctoral fellow position at the Australian National University. And while I was there, I was actually recruited back to a faculty position at Mount Allison University. And I was super excited to take that position up because I thought, this is great. I'll have the opportunity to hopefully inspire some other students to participate in research, or maybe at least help them figure out what they don't want to do, as the case was with me. But while I was at Mount Allison, the opportunity came up at Lethbridge. And I have to be honest, being a Maritimer, I had to Google Lethbridge. I didn't know where Lethbridge was. There is a Lethbridge in Newfoundland, too. But I didn't know where Lethbridge, Alberta was. And when I came here, I was absolutely amazed. It was actually the first stop in a series of interviews that I had set up. But I couldn't believe the quality of the colleagues of here in the Department of Chemistry and Biochemistry in particular, and now I've expanded in order to appreciate more widely the quality of colleagues that we have at the university. The instrumentation that's available in the Department of Chemistry and Biochemistry, the facilities that we have available to us here in Lethbridge rival those of much larger institutions. And there is a growing graduate program. And I thought, this is the place for me, because we still have that strong belief in undergraduate education, so I could still participate in research with undergraduate students, but I could expand my program in order to include graduate students as well. So that's what I've done. This is a list of a few of the students that have participated in research in my lab over the past few years in no particular order. This includes high school students, undergraduate, graduate students, as well as postdoctoral fellows. And what you might not know about the University of Lethbridge is the quality of students that we have. And this is a picture of some of my current group. Now, I need to explain this a little bit, I guess, don't I? Although you're enjoying beverages too, so maybe you can appreciate this. This picture was taken after a long day at a national chemistry conference in Halifax, Nova Scotia. And at this conference, everybody in this picture presented the results from their research. In fact, the two that look happiest, perhaps the two on either end, won awards for their presentation. That's the quality of students we have at the University of Lethbridge. These students competed against chemistry students from across the country and outshone those other students to the judges in terms of the quality of the research they were doing and their ability to communicate science. So I was a proud mama that day, and I thought we should have some fun. So we found this great little pub on the waterfront in Halifax. But the other reason I wanted to show this particular picture is because every single student in this picture has acronyms after their name. And these acronyms represent prestigious institutional, provincial, and national scholarships, where again, our students at the University of Lethbridge compete with students in chemistry and other science discipline for these major awards. And these students, there's six of them, have brought in well over $500,000 to the University of Lethbridge to support their studies here. So I'm very proud. Of course, I also need my own money, and that often when students come to the lab, they might not have the research portfolio yet in order to compete at the national level. So I do need money to hire my own students and take them to conferences. I should mention we do bring undergraduate students to conferences too. It just happened that year. There weren't any that were able to attend. They need computers, printers, and all that kind of stuff. So I'm definitely thankful for my funders for that as well. Now, on my last slide, I want to end on a personal note. These are three pictures of the family that I was born into. So I'm the baby in all these pictures. I don't know what happened to me. I was really cute back then. If I do say so myself. So this is a picture of my mom and I, my dad and I, and my sister and I. So I come from a family of four. And over the past year and a half, three out of the four have received cancer diagnosis. That's a small family of four. Three out of the four. This is a picture of my current family. My husband, Steve, sits proudly, hopefully, over here. I hope he's proud. and my son and my daughter. And I often look at this family of four and wonder what the future is going to bring. Now, I do not want you to walk away tonight thinking that I've told you that I'm going to be the cure for cancer and I will find that cure for cancer. That's not what my message is. My message is that as scientists, we have to use many different approaches, including computers. We need to understand the function inside the cell from many different angles, including chemistry. And only through that will we be in a position in order to push ourselves forward and hopefully find a solution. Another way to look at it is that maybe one of the students that happens to pass through my lab and comes out with a little better knowledge of chemistry will then go on and find themselves in a medical research lab and be able to use that knowledge in a different way. So thank you very much for your attention.